Hi, everybody. Welcome to Lecture 27. Now, before we get started, I know I always start class with a little song or two, but before I get into it, I'd love you to tell me what you think that compound is over there. It's a very popular organic compound. Let me give you a little time to think about it. Now I'll play the little song. Grow apart from Orgoland. Maybe you'll never grow apart from Orgoland. Oh. Well, did you figure out what that compound was? Yep. This is its long name, but most of us know this as THC, the drug in marijuana and cannabis. So it gives you a little high, all right? So Orgo is everywhere. Being able to synthesize this could put a lot of people out of business. There's a challenge for you. Anyway, just thought I'd throw that out there. Today, Orgoland Tour visits Oxidation Island. Yes, a new little location in our Orgoland area. So the sites we're gonna see are listed below. These are all from section 10.14. Yep, I jumped way over a bunch of sections because I love this stuff and I can't wait to get to it. I couldn't wait to the end of the chapter of 10, so I brought it in and I'd like to talk a little bit about it now. It's very cool stuff, okay? So let's start looking at these organic molecules that are getting oxidized. This is kind of new. In general, all your intro chem, you looked at other molecules getting oxidized. Today, our main focus is going to be looking at these organic molecules and seeing how they get oxidized. And it's true, I can't just do oxidation without reduction. So there are things that are going to get reduced, but the focus of Orgoland will always be what organic molecules are getting oxidized and what they get oxidized into. Okay, let's take a closer look. So if we are looking specifically at oxidation reactions, then what we are really looking at are molecules like alcohols that start with one bond to a carbon and an oxygen, and you start removing hydrogens to produce more oxygen bonds. This is when finally oxidation has a true meaning. Oxidation means oxygenating. You are putting more oxygens on your organic molecules. The more oxygen bonds you can form, the more oxidation you have done. Isn't that cool? It's no longer just Leo goes grr or oil rig to try to get it into your brain. You just spy any organic molecule that starts gaining oxygen bonds, like this one here, and you've spied an oxidation. Yes, something is getting reduced, but remember the focus now will be on the oxidation piece. And you can see to get new oxygen bonds, I have to lose something. So I will always be losing hydrogen. The one thing I will never, ever lose in an oxidation of an organic molecule are carbon-carbon bonds. The carbon skeletal structure must remain the same. I can only remove hydrogen. So, in review, oxidation is always going to increase the number of oxygen bonds and lose hydrogens. And reduction must be when I decrease the number of oxygen bonds. I could be going, and there is a possibility if I ever wanted to go this way. Not in today's video, but at another time, maybe I could do a reduction of a C double bond O to a COH. Okay? Usually these reduction pieces that we use to oxidize our organic molecules come in the form of metals, like chromium plus 6 can get reduced to chromium plus 3. Okay? They're very popular. I knew you were going to ask this. Why should we care? Why should you care about organic molecules that get oxidized or not? So I was thinking of a way to tell you this, and to tell you the truth, I had to take a little time out to come up with a good story. Kind of a little.
So. Nibbling on sponge cake, watching the sun bake. All of those tourists covered with oil.
So yes, it takes me a little Jimmy Buffett just to kind of siesta time and think about what and why should we care about oxidation reactions. So this is my family taking a vacation several years ago. And that's my wife and my father and my sister-in-law. And we're all having cervezas, relaxing by the pool, by the ocean. It was quite a time. And my dad all of a sudden was running low on that cerveza he was drinking. And so he asked me, he said, Nick, go get some more cervezas down at the market down the street, would you? Go pick up another six pack. And I said to myself, that's my little cerveza over here on the far right there. And it's empty too, and I've had a few. So, do I get in a car and risk driving to the market with a little beer in me just to get a six pack and maybe risk getting pulled over by the police and getting thrown in jail? Not a fun place to get thrown in jail anywhere. But I thought of this. I know. You're thinking, wait, how does this deal with oxidation? This is how. Watch. I was thinking this, that if I did get pulled over, they probably would give me a breathalyzer, right? One of these. They'd give me a breathalyzer test. Oh, there it is. And in this breathalyzer, I would blow into it. And the way this breathalyzer actually works is an oxidation reaction. Would you know? Here is what actually happens. This breathalyzer actually has some chromium plus 6 in it, a little solution of chromium plus 6. And when you breathe your breath through it, if it contains any alcohol like that ethanol right there, which is the main source of alcohol in our beer and wine, and if you breathe through that chromium plus 6 and the ethanol feels the chromium plus 6, it's going to go through this oxidation reaction. And notice the ethanol is going to turn into acetic acid, which has a lot more oxygen bonds on it. It got oxygenated. It went through an oxidation. Now, that's not such a big deal. The big deal is that the chromium plus 6 got reduced to chromium plus 3. And there's a little spectrophotometer in these breathalyzers that measures how green, tealish green, does the chromium plus 6 turn into. How does that color go away? The more color goes away of orange, the more green, the teal blue it gets, the more trouble I'm in, and I'm in jail. But then I thought to myself, well, wait, maybe if I explain all this chemistry to the police officer, they'll let me off. They'll be like, no, he can't be drunk. How could he? He understands all this chemistry. But then again, I thought, no, I better not risk it. So me and my sister, we just went to the beach. That's my sis. She's awesome. We just went to the beach and I just sat around getting a natural high, thinking about, I wonder what everybody else is doing in Orgoland today. So that was my vacation experience that ties into oxidation, and maybe you too can use this example at some point in your life. I don't know. Orgo could be useful. So organic oxidation reactions are not only used in breathalyzers, but our body is doing tons of orgo oxidation reactions all the time. Please feel free to see me if you have any questions about those. Back to our story. Now that we know oxidations really matter, let's look at what kind of molecules they can oxidize besides ethanol, because maybe you're gonna wanna do reactions other than breathalyzers. So we can take that ethanol, which is a primary alcohol. One example of a primary alcohol. And we could oxidize it to the aldehyde. But noticed in that breathalyzer, it didn't stop at the aldehyde. It got oxidized all the way to the carboxylic acid. Okay? Or we could take a secondary alcohol. And we could oxidize the secondary alcohol to just the ketone. Notice it has to stop here because there are no more hydrogens on the carbon. And I can't break the carbon skeleton when I do oxidation reactions. So I stop. Secondary alcohols can only make ketones. If I add the tertiary alcohol, then are there any hydrogens on that tertiary alcohol's carbon? None. So tertiary alcohols do not go through oxidation at all. No oxidation reaction. Okay? And this is kind of what we're going to play with in terms of how do I want to turn my alcohols into possibly different functional groups like ketones, aldehydes, carboxylic acids. Orgoland's about to explode into these three new little suburbs. Okay? What are some good oxidizing agents that will allow me to get to all those cool places? Here's the list. Looks very convoluted. Take a second to step back, but notice all of these have chromium in them. So all of these reagents are chromium reagents. And when these species react in H2SO4, they generate H2CrO4. So you could either see this oxidizing agent in one of those forms up above, or in red, the H2CrO4, the chromic acid reagent. And that is the name given to it in its popular form, chromic acid reagent. And this is a really great oxidizing agent. It'll take primary alcohols and take them all the way to carboxylic acids. Oxidize the heck out of them. It's awesome. And take secondary alcohols to ketones. Perfect, you get huge yield. This is a great reaction. There's only one problem. Only one problem. Chromium is a heavy metal. And as heavy metals go, they're very toxic to our environment. And therefore, we could use this chromium reagent, but we'd have to throw it out somewhere. And some people have been throwing it out in not so nice places, such as rivers and streams, and takes our beautiful orange chromium solution and turns our rivers into chromium orange rivers. It's very nasty and very hard to get rid of. So, on paper, not a problem. You're not destroying anything when you do paper chemistry with chromic acid reagent. But in the lab, when you go to lab, like our lab nine that you would see. In lab nine, we try a greener, kind of more environmentally friendly oxidizing agent, okay, known as hypochlorous acid. So these two compounds, sodium hypochlorite and acetic acid, are combined in solution and immediately react to make hypochlorous acid, which is a very good oxidizing agent. And it will take our secondary alcohols and turn them into ketones, and our primary alcohols and turn them into carboxylic acid. So as you notice, it's a great substitute for our chromic acid reagent. And that's why we use it in lab today. Now, what if you wanted to stop? Where's my aldehyde? Aldehyde, where are you? I want an aldehyde. How can I make an aldehyde? Where are you, aldehyde? So this is how you make an aldehyde. You need to use this one chromium reagent. It is a milder chromium reagent. Again, still toxic, but it's the only one we know that can actually stop and be very efficient at stopping the reaction at an aldehyde or a ketone. So this is known as pyridinium chlorochromate. You will see it often referred to, and you can now forever refer to it as PCC, so that you don't have to always write out the structure of this molecule or the name pyridinium chlorochromate. And when you see that, you're in good shape for producing an aldehyde from a primary alcohol. Notice how it's different than the primary alcohols making carboxylic acids. So now you have a synthetic route on how to take any alcohols to ketones, aldehydes, and carboxylic acids. My kids here are trying to give you some motivation. They're very excited about the fact that you're about to tell me what the major product is from the following reactions, plural, two-step synthesis. Okay? And they like have so much confidence in you. Look at them. They're all smiling at you. They know you can do it. So take a second here. See if you can figure out what the final product of this reaction is. And notice one thing. I will never, ever ask you to show me the reaction mechanism for a redox reaction. In this video today, there were very few arrows flying around going one electron bond here, breaking a bond there. No reaction mechanisms. Reaction mechanisms are very hard to draw for redox reactions. Very hard. And sometimes a bit hypothetical, and sometimes just wrong. So we will not try to draw redox reaction mechanisms ever for our course. Hopefully that doesn't turn it into magic. Now you just buy chromium or PCC, and you know there's got to be an oxidation that takes place. All right, I'll give you a couple seconds to figure this problem out. Ready? Go. All right. Got it? Of course, you could have pressed the pause button, I know. All right, so here are the products that I formed from each step of this reaction. So in the first reaction, we have a very strong base, OH minus. Okay, and sitting in OH minus, we have a primary aliphatic and we have a secondary aliphatic. So as you know from previous classes, again, familiarity, I'll just keep bringing up past stuff to go along with new stuff, making our whole map of Orgoland feel like we've been traveling every road all the time. These will produce an SN2 reaction here and an E2 reaction on the secondary leaving group with the bromide to produce this really cool alkene and this really cool alcohol. Two for one. Then add the PCC that you can see up there. Okay, add that PCC over there to this. And the PCC is only going to pay special attention to this alcohol and leave the alkene all alone. PCC, aldehyde. So now it's really important that we start to really get comfy with these functional groups so that you know the difference between an aldehyde, a ketone, and a carboxylic acid, so that you're able to draw them now that you know the reagents that are used to make them. I hope this has been fun. I love oxidation. That's why I threw it in here a little earlier in chapter 10 than normally. And our next video, we'll start looking at amines, because amines are cool too. All right. I hope you have a good time. I hope you're feeling good. I hope everybody you know is healthy and well. Take care of yourself. Bye.